Okay, thank you very much. Good morning. I'm also making a sort of journey into the past, and the activities I'm going to talk about started 30 years ago, approximately 30 years ago. At that time, I was a postdoc in von Glitzing's group. So that's a picture of this group, and that's not our regular outfit at that time, but that was a so-called Kohl and Pinkel party, must have been 88 or 89. So this is actually Klaus von Glitzing. That's me at the side, and that's Rolf Gerhardt. And here is a larger picture of Rolf Gerhardt. So he was involved in the theory with this lateral superlattices we investigated at that time. And he was accompanied by Daniela Pfannkuche. And later, the group was joined by Jürgen Smet, who was also very important in resolving at least the Chicklet-Hofstadter butterfly I'm going to talk about. He also continued his work after I have left here for Regensburg. And in Regensburg, our activities on lateral superlattices was supported theoretically by Ulrich Rössler's group. Main person is actually missing. I have no picture of him. That's Christian Albrecht. So he worked during his PhD on resolving the Hofstadter butterfly experimentally. Okay, what was our motivation? The motivation was to the quest for high mobility electronic devices, for electronic applications, and also to explore novel effects which require clean, low-dimensional electron systems. So that time was briefly after discovering the quantum Hall effect and the fractional quantum Hall effect, and a lot of ideas were around what to make with low-dimensional electronic systems. So there was suggestions by Professor Sakaki from Japan to make one-dimensional structures, so wires made of one-dimensional electron of two-dimensional electron gases, or also these V-grooved systems. But there were also ideas to pattern semiconductors into to make lateral superlattices from semiconductors. Here, a semiconductor with one-dimensional grating, here with two-dimensional grating, one-dimensional structure with grating, and so on. And the main idea was to generate a novel band structure which, for example, suppresses phonon scattering and improves the mobility of these systems. So based on these ideas, we investigated quite a lot of different types of superlattices. So we investigated two-dimensional electron systems superimposed with a one-dimensional periodic potential. And weak periodic potential means that the modulation of the system, the energy of this modulation amplitude, was always much smaller than the Fermi energy in the system. We also investigated magnetic superlattices, so stripes of ferromagnetic material on top of a two-dimensional electron gas to generate periodic magnetic fields. And we also looked into strong periodic potentials, so-called antitot potentials, where these pillars constitute repulsive potential peaks which scatter the electrons, and that gives actually rise to chaotic dimensions. So at that time, we also worked a lot with Theo Geisel, who is here in the audience. Actually, this picture is from one of his publications, and with Klaus Richter here in Regensburg. So he quantized this chaotic motion by means of Gutzwiller's trace formula. In the following, I will only concentrate on these weak one-dimensional and two-dimensional periodic potentials. And so that's the outline of what I'm going to talk. So first, I show you or introduce you to the magnetoresistance. So that's longitudinal magnetoresistance and Hall resistance of a simple two-dimensional electron gas, which is subjected to a perpendicular magnetic field. Then I discuss the magnetoresistance in the presence of a weak one-dimensional periodic potential. And then the main part, I'm going to discuss the magnetoresistance in a weak two-dimensional periodic potential. There, that's where the Hofstadter butterfly comes into the game. And the main ingredient for lateral superlattices are two-dimensional electron systems. So you can find a two-dimensional electron gas in many electronic devices, probably also in this Rumpelstilzchen computer. And MOSFET consists of a source contact, a drain contact, and insulator, and on top a metallic gate. So if one applies a gate voltage to this metallic gate, an inversion layer of electrons emerges at this interface. So it's bound to the interface. And this layer of two-dimensional electron gas is confined in a nearly triangular potential well at the silicon dioxide semiconductor interface. The electron density in this two-dimensional electron gas can be simply estimated from a simple capacitor model. So the charge you put on the upper plate, you find as a negative charge in the inversion channel. Okay, now we have a two-dimensional electron gas which is confined at the interface. And as you know, an electron in a potential box, that gives rise to quantization. And indeed, the motion of the electrons perpendicular to the interface is quantized. One obtains so-called subbands with the lowest energy E0, and the states are occupied up to an upper energy, the Fermi level. And the motion parallel to the interface actually is free. So the dispersion, so the energy of the electrons is given by this type of formula. So there is a quantized motion in z direction perpendicular to the interface, and there is a conventional free electron dispersion for the electrons in x and y directions, so parallel to the interface. So here is a picture of this parabolic continuous dispersion. Here is a picture of the K space, so the electronic states are occupied up to the Fermi energy Kf. So now what happens if a magnetic field, a strong magnetic field is applied? Electrons move on cyclotron orbits with radius Rc and with cyclotron frequency omega c, which increases linearly with the magnetic field strengths. As a consequence of this orbital motion, the energy gets quantized and one obtains the so-called Landau levels. These Landau levels are shown here. So in gray, that's actually the density of states of the electron gas without any magnetic field. It's continuous. And a strong magnetic field leads to completely discrete electron levels, which are described by this formula. N is an integer, and h bar omega c is the cyclotron energy. The Landau levels are highly degenerate. This means you can fill quite a number of electrons in one level. That's described by the so-called Landau degeneracy. And the density of electrons which fits into one or in each Landau level is proportional to the magnetic field. This has the following consequence. Shown here is the energy spectrum. So this spectrum as a function of magnetic field. So you see this fan chart for Landau quantum number n equals 0, 1, 2, and so on. And since with increasing magnetic field, you can fill more electrons in one Landau level, the Fermi energy jumps from the higher Landau levels to the lower Landau levels if the magnetic field is increased. And in the following, we will simply use this scheme to move the Fermi level through a Landau level. So in this, during this journey, the Fermi level is actually tuned through a Landau level. You can forget all these complicated oscillations. The main purpose of this is that by increasing the magnetic field, we tune the Fermi energy from the upper edge of the Landau level to the lower edge of the Landau level. Okay, that was the energy structure. Now to the magnetoresistance. And the most famous effects in two dimensions, that's the quantum Hall effect. And that was originally measured in these type of structures. So these are silicon MOSFETs. A current is flowing through the two-dimensional electron gas, and one measures the Hall voltage perpendicular to this current flow, and one can measure the longitudinal voltage. So here is the sketch of the devices. That's the scheme I've shown you before. There is an inversion layer, a two-dimensional layer of electrons, and that's the sketch of the devices you can see here on this micrograph. So there is a two-dimensional electron gas underneath, and one measures simply the Hall voltage in the presence of a perpendicular magnetic field which points out of the plane. So that's the original graph. Shown here is the Hall voltage and the longitudinal voltage, so the voltage drop along the current flow as a function of the gate voltage. So the magnetic field was in this case fixed, probably 12 Tesla or 18 Tesla, something like that. And the carrier density was tuned. And you can see oscillations here. At the most important features are these steps in the Hall voltage. And if one divides the value of the measured voltage, UH, divided by the current which is flowing through the channel, that gives a resistance. And this resistance is given by H over E squared, Planck's constant, an elementary charge, and nu is an integer. So that's very precisely quantized. So here is a more didactical view of the measured graph. So there appear in the Hall resistivity quantized steps, H over 2E squared, H over 3E squared. And this will play a role later on. And there are these oscillations in the resistance. These are Shubnikov-De Haas oscillations, and they actually reflect the density of states. You remember the discrete Landau levels, and that simply reflects the discrete Landau levels. When there is a maximum in the resistivity, the Fermi level is in a Landau level, and if there is a zero, the Fermi level is in between two Landau levels. Okay, now what happens when we impose a one-dimensional periodic potential? And that was our first experiment in this direction. We used an optical technique to generate a one-dimensional periodic potential. So there was our sample. In that case, it was not a silicon MOSFET, but a semiconductor heterostructure, but it doesn't matter. It has a two-dimensional electron gas. There was an expanded laser beam, and by two mirrors which surrounded the sample, we generated an interference pattern on top of the semiconductor surface in the cryostat, so at 4.2 Kelvin. So that's how schematically the interference pattern, when you interfere two plane waves, looks like. You get a sine square modulation, so an intensity modulation that's on top of the semiconductor surface. And this modulated intensity modulated the deep donors in the aluminum gallium arsenide in this case. So to make the story short, we get a one-dimensional modulation of the electrons in the two-dimensional electron gas. Now the magnetoresistance looked as the following. That's the Hall resistance. That was actually boring. but the longitudinal resistivity rho as a function of the magnetic field showed novel features. Namely, there were periodic oscillations, 1/B periodic oscillations. There at higher magnetic field, Shubnikov-De Haas oscillations, which stem from the Landau quantization, appeared. The minima of these oscillations appeared whenever the cyclotron orbit diameter equals m, which is an integer, minus 1/4 the period A of the superlattice. So the period A was given in this case by the angle of the mirrors. So that's a commensurability effect, and there are two competing length scales in the problem. So one is the magnetic length, or the cyclotron diameter, the cyclotron radius, and the other length is the period of our artificial superlattice. Okay, and the origin of this effect, so there are several levels of explanation, but it comes finally down if you analyze the Landau level spectrum. I told you that we have a weak periodic potential. This means one can calculate the effect of the periodic potential in perturbation theory. And so you assume such a cosine potential, and the energy is then given by the Landau energy plus this perturbation term, and that can be approximated by this formula, which contains this cosine term. So what happens is the periodic potential, which is superimposed, transforms the discrete Landau levels into Landau bands. So that's shown here. Before, we had here discrete Landau levels, which are separated by h bar omega c. Due to the periodic potential, we get Landau bands. And the bandwidth of these bands depends on the energy. Whenever this cosine term becomes zero, and actually what's inside there is simply the commensurability condition I've shown you before, 2RC is equal to m minus 1/4 the period A. Whenever that is fulfilled, the correction vanishes, and therefore the Landau levels become flat. And the Landau level spectrum is here shown again as before, now as a function of the magnetic field. So without modulation, we had here the straight lines. But due to the periodic potential, we get a modulation broadening, which oscillates as a function of magnetic field and energy. So the one-dimensional periodic potential transforms the discrete Landau levels into Landau bands, which have a varying width, and the width varies with magnetic field and energy. Okay, that brings me now actually to the last point, where we now investigated the magnetoresistance in a two-dimensional periodic potential. And so one can view what happens then is that these Landau bands, which occur in a one-dimensional periodic potential, gets again split. You can view this as type of Bragg reflection. But at this point, the Hofstadter butterfly comes into the game. So the additional periodic potential in y direction opens gaps in these Landau bands. And the splitting of the Landau bands is described by Hofstadter's butterfly, and the spectrum depends, as you have heard before, on the flux through the unit cell of our artificial superlattice. It was already mentioned before, so why does one not see any effect of the spectrum in a real crystal? The reason is that in a real crystal, lattice constants are of order 0.3 nanometers, and in order to be in the relevant magnetic field range to see the spectrum, so to squeeze one flux quantum through the unit cell of the lattice, you would need a magnetic field strength of 46,000 tesla, which is a bit out of reach experimentally. So you have to resort to this type of lateral superlattices in order to see signatures of this spectrum. And one feature of this spectrum is that if the flux is, for example, 3/2, then the Landau band splits into 3 subbands. And this should be visible in transport. So a Landau level is reflected by 1 Shubnikov de Haas peak. So if 1 Landau band splits into 3 subbands, a Landau Shubnikov de Haas peak should split into 3 peaks. So that's what we were looking for. So that's how the Hofstadter butterfly comes into this problem. So that's, again, a plot I've shown you already in 2 versions. So that's the Landau levels as a function of, in this case, of the inverse magnetic field. No, it should be magnetic field, okay. And the Hofstadter butterfly is actually the internal structure of each Landau band. One cannot expect an experiment to resolve this recursive structure and the self-similarity, so nature trickles too much in terms of impurity scattering, and the largest gaps in our system were only a few microelectron volts wide. If you estimate the effect of scattering, although we have a pretty clean system, the broadening is of order also 50 microelectron volts. So that's the same order of magnitude as the gap size you can expect. And KBT at 1 Kelvin is 86 microelectron volts. So you see you have to go to very low temperatures in the millikelvin regime in order to have a chance to resolve these gaps. So that's then actually a calculation of Daniela Pfannkuche and Rolf Gerhards, who calculated the density of states in a two-dimensional periodic potential. So these are, again, the Landau levels. And you see here the splitting of 1 Landau band into 3 subbands. So that corresponds to phi node or phi of value of 1/3, for example. So you can, in experiment, only expect to see the most the largest gaps in the spectrum. There is no chance to resolve really this intricate recursive structure. So here we use a different technique. So we used gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide heterostructure. The details are not important. So again, there is a two-dimensional electron gas at the interface between these two semiconducting materials. So we have here in red the two-dimensional electron gas in the semiconductor wafer. Then one patterns Hall bars from this device, alloys contacts. And then the whole structure was covered with a resist, and into this resist, we drilled holes by means of electron beam lithography. Then the whole structure was covered with a metal, and a gate voltage was applied with respect to the two-dimensional channel. So that's how the completed device looked like. We have here the two-dimensional electron gas, and this corrugated gate gave rise to a weak two-dimensional periodic potential. That's shown here. So what's actually modulated is the bottom of the conduction band, or the subband energy is zero, and the Fermi energy is lying well above this modulation of the subband energy. So we have a weak two-dimensional periodic potential. Now the experimental evidence of the Hofstadter spectrum requires that, I told it already, that you have a splitting of the Shubnikov de Haas peaks according to the flux penetrating unit cell. Then one should be able to identify the gaps by temperature dependent measurements. And finally, an important point, which I did not mention yet, is an anomalous Hall conductivity when the Fermi level is in a gap of this Hofstadter spectrum. So let me address this point in a bit more detail. So the question is, what is the Hall conductivity if the Fermi level is in a gap of the spectrum? So we had these Landau bands, and within these Landau bands, there is the gaps are described by the Hofstadter spectrum. So there could be that the Fermi level is inside a Landau band in such a gap. And there is a very general argument by Laughlin stating that the Hall conductivity is an integer times E squared over H. But it is not clear from this argument what the value of this integer is. And the answer was given by Saules and Streda. So there is this famous TKNN paper by Saules. They analyzed the Hall conductivity and they used the Hofstadter spectrum as a toy model for their system. And their answer was that sigma xy is given by m plus n e squared over h. N is trivial, that's simply the number of occupied Landau levels below the Fermi energy, so the fully occupied Landau levels. And m is an integer, and this integer is determined by an Diophantine equation, which reads g is w times q plus m times p. So m, that's the m which is in this Hall conductivity. And g, that's actually the gap index. So for example, if we are here at, say, 2/3 at the spectrum, the band, in our case, the Landau band, splits into 1, 2, 3 subbands. And this gap here, this largest gap, would have the index 1. P and Q is given by the magnetic flux penetrating the unit cell. And there is this boundary condition for W. And so you can extract this value of M. So by using this equation, you can now calculate the Hall conductivity you expect in each of these gaps. And that's shown here. So in this large gap, we have 0. If we would be in this gap, we would have a Hall conductivity of 1 e squared over h. And I should say that for this plot, n was put to 0. So that's simply an offset of these integer numbers. If one would be in this smaller gap here, the Hall conductivity would be 3 e squared over h. So that was the prediction of Saules. And actually, this paper, TKNN, was also the start of the topology in band structure theory. And it was therefore the paper which was one of the reasons he got the Nobel Prize last year. Also, the symmetry is quite symmetric. There is a peculiar asymmetry regarding the Hall conductivity. So assume we tune the Fermi level at a flux given by phi naught over phi by equal to 1/3. Then the sequence of the Hall conductivity, if we go from the lower end to the upper end, would be 0, 0, 1, 1. If we do the same experiment at this position here and tune the Fermi level through the spectrum, one would obtain the sequence of the Hall conductivity 0, 1, 0, 1. Okay, what's seen in experiment? What I show you here now is the longitudinal resistivity as a function of magnetic field, and the black trace, that's the Hall conductivity. Actually, it's 1 over the Hall resistivity, but that's actually very, it's a very good approximation of sigma xy. Okay, it looks a little bit complicated. I will guide you through these complicated traces. So first, these dashed lines. At these dashed lines, we have the flat band condition. So here, we do not see the modulation broadening of the lambda bands, and we cannot expect to see any structure at these dashed positions. Here, in this magnetic field range, we are in this area of the Hofstadter butterfly. So assuming that we cannot resolve the fine structure, we have a splitting of the Landau band into 1, 2, 3 bands. And indeed, we see a splitting of an individual peak into 1, 2, 3 sub-peaks. These data were taken at 50 milli-K, but if you increase to 1.5K, that's completely gone. I told you that the gaps you expect are smaller than KT at 1 Kelvin. Then if we look to the structures, to the Shubnikov-De Haas oscillations here, we are at this position, so slightly right of the Hofstadter, of the center of the butterfly. So these states, so the number of the states here and here dominate the small number of states here. So we expect essentially the splitting into two peaks, what is actually seen here. And if you continue to move inside the butterfly, so now we are in this region, we see a pretty complicated structure. What we expect here is a splitting into three subbands. So there is one, this branch, so these subbands, and this subband. And what we have here is actually two modulation broadened Landau bands which overlap. So let me clarify this with some arrows here. So LG and LG, so these gaps, these are Landau gaps, which separate Landau levels. And this additional structure, that actually comes from the butterfly, from the Hofstadter spectrum. So we see, as you can see in this picture, four gaps, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's one, there is only a weak shoulder, 3 and 4. Even more interesting is the Hall conductance. I told you that there is an asymmetry of the Hall conductivity if you move on the right-hand side or on the left-hand side through the butterfly. So let's start at this position. So we expect from the Saulis theory that we have the sequence 0 here, 1, 0, 1. So that's shown here. And in experiment, what we see is, so this line, that's the offset, that would correspond to 0. That is 1. The Hall conductivity does not completely reach the quantized value. You have to keep in mind that our the gaps are not fully resolved. They do not go to 0. If the gap would be fully developed, the traces should go to 0. But nevertheless, you see a clear tendency that the Hall conductivity is going up, is going down, and that's the sequence 0, 1, 0, 1. And that's repeated again with a different offset, 0, 1, 0, 1. Okay, here the structure is very weak, but you see still the tendency. How about the Hall conductivity on the other side of the butterfly? So that's actually at this position here. And here, I told you before, you expect the sequence 0, 0, 1, 1. And indeed, we start here, so that would be the 0. Then we move through this first subband. The Hall conductance does not change. Then we move through the central peak of the subband. There, the Hall conductivity changes abruptly to the next quantized value, and then it stays constant. So indeed, we get the predicted sequence 0, 0, 1, 1. And we see also the asymmetry, whether Q over P is smaller than 1/2 or larger than 1/2. So here is this section I've shown you here, magnified. Okay, no new information. So that's again the sequence 0, 1, 0, 1, as predicted theoretically, 0, 1, 0, 1. We have done the same thing in another superlattice with 100 nanometer periodicity. Again, the dashed lines correspond areas where you cannot see any splitting, so that's the region where the bands are flat, where we have no modulation broadening. But in between, so here we are again in this regime where we have two dominating outer subbands, and we see the splitting into two subbands. Again, if you go to 1.5 Kelvin, all the structure is gone. Here we are in a region, if we again assume we can only resolve the largest gap, which is this gap here and that this gap there, we get a splitting into three peaks. You need a little bit loving eyes. So here is a change of slope. So this gap is very little pronounced. But nevertheless, if you look to the Hall conductance, you see again the characteristic sequence 0, 1, 0, 1, as expected for the right branch of the butterfly. Okay, that brings me to the summary. So that's actually the jiggled version of the butterfly you can resolve in experiments. Are only these large gaps which can be resolved in experiment. And what I've shown you is that we can indeed also the predicted sequence of the Hall conductivity, which is 0, 0, 1, 1 on the left-hand side and 0, 1, 0, 1, so non-monotonous on the right-hand side. And I think we will hear much more on this topic, since 13 years after our publication, there are now three groups who published work on Hofstadter butterfly on graphene superlattices. And the main difference to semiconductor is that you can go to still smaller periods, typically 14 nanometers, where in our case, typically 100 nanometer was the lower limit. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, Dieter, thank you very much for this very clear and interesting talk. We are, well, a bit behind schedule. Are there one or two shorter questions? Paul, yeah.
Is this possible to measure with a reasonable resolution, not DC conductivity, but AC with the frequency?
AC? How AC? Are you talking about hertz or kilohertz or megahertz?
No, small. That's I don't know the scale, but you have plateaus, uh-huh. Right? And but we know that it's actually not plateau. You simply don't resolve. Uh-huh. Smaller plateaus.
Yeah.
With the frequency, instead of plateau, is expected to see power law with certain mm-hmm. exponent. And then I wonder whether this exponent, or power law at least, mm-hmm. could be resolved. It's actually not plateau, but it's a steps. Mm-hmm. But with the frequency, they smoothed to some smooth curve, which is expected to be power law with certain exponents. And I wonder whether it could be resolved.
Might be, but we have not looked into that. And I mean, the experiments are pretty difficult, as you can imagine. And we also did not continue, since we were already at the highest possible mobilities. And you cannot go infinitely deep into the semiconductor crystal, where you can actually increase the mobility. So the mobility of these samples had, say, 1.5 million. you can have 16 millions, but then your electron gas is buried 300 nanometer below the surface, and then it's impossible to impose a periodic potential which is much smaller than the depths. So these sort of samples, the semiconductor samples, were so state of the art and still state of the present art, and we stopped 20 years ago.
Okay, I think we should also stop here now. We will have a shortened coffee break. I suggest that we reconvene in 15 minutes.